BASF. We create chemistry.
This series sets out to provide access to highly qualified and well-respected independent scientists to explain the science underpinning important policy debates. And in this case, we will be addressing maximum residue limits, MRLs. There's a huge spectrum of different levels of expertise on the line today, from real experts at the one end of the spectrum to people like myself with a very superficial understanding of what an MRL is. So Caroline, you're going to have a challenge to keep us all on board. But what's important is that we all have at least a working understanding of what an MRL is by the end of this webinar. But to get in the mood, we will start with an online poll. And then from there, we will go on to a presentation by Caroline. And following that, we're going to have a Q&A. There'll be plenty of time for questions and answers, so please bear that in mind. We will have plenty of time, and Caroline has very kindly offered to follow up with anybody who has further questions or concerns following the meeting. You will all get a copy of Caroline's full slide set. She won't show the full slide set today, but you'll all get a full slide set with Caroline's contact details. I think before we go any further, I would like to take this opportunity to thank you all for dialing in, to say a big thank you to Caroline for agreeing to make this talk. And first of all, it's my pleasure to really introduce Dr. Caroline Harris. Caroline is a principal scientist and director for chemical regulation and food safety at Exponent International, which I hope you don't mind Caroline in saying is one of the leading consultancies and experts organizations of its type in the world. Caroline trained as an analytical chemist and has a PhD in clinical medicine and is a senior fellow of the Royal Society of Chemistry. She was a regulator in the UK's what we call PSD, Pesticide Safety Directorate, for 15 years before moving to Exponent. And whilst at Exponent, to this very day, Caroline's everyday work involves MRLs, import tolerances, and consumer exposure assessments. So she's a real practicing expert in the field. As a regulator, Caroline was also involved in developing and establishing many of the guidelines, the scientific guidelines and procedures which are still used by regulators today. In the past, Caroline was a member of the UK government's Advisory Committee on Pesticides, or ACP, and is currently a member of the UK's Committee on Toxicity of Chemicals in Food, Consumer Products and the Environment. On a more international level, Caroline is a member of IUPAC, that's the International Union of Pure and Applied Chemistry, and Caroline represents IUPAC on CODEX, the Committee on Pesticide Residues. Please therefore join me in welcoming Caroline. And take note of any questions that you have during the talk. But in the meantime, we would like to get in the mood by asking you to share your thoughts and your perceptions via an online poll. You go to menti.com, put in the code 9203705, which is on the screen. Andrea, it's not on the screen anymore. Let me repeat the code. It's 9203705, and you will see a number of questions. The first one of which is, what's the purpose of MRLs? So we'll give you a couple of minutes to fill that one in. Please keep your answers short. Okay, thank you very much. Let's go to the next question. Are crops with pesticide residues above MRLs safe to eat? Okay, let's move on to the next question. Are MRLs required for organic crops? Okay, so now for a final question. This one's a bit more cerebral. And you can answer anything you want from no idea to less than 5%, but which percentage of crops officially monitored in the EU have pesticide residues exceeding MRLs? Okay, fantastic. We have quite a spectrum of answers. It'll be very interesting to see how that would evolve during your talk, Caroline.
Yep.
So I think at this point, it's best for me to hand over to you, Caroline. Thank you very much again. We look forward to hearing what you have to say, and we'll have the questions and answers following your talk. Over to you.
Okay, thank you very much, Paul, for that very kind introduction. Good morning or good afternoon, everybody. It really is my pleasure to be here today talking to you about MRLs. And I was given a question: can you talk about whether MRLs are trading or safety standards? And what I'm going to try and do is mostly just give you the information that I have, but I have a few slides to share as well. So please bear with me as I switch between various views as we're going forward. Hopefully the technology doesn't fail. So let's start with the basics about pesticide residues and MRLs. And we really are starting with the basics here. So when a pesticide is applied to a crop, it may leave traces of the pesticide or its metabolites on the treated food, which remains when it's harvested and or placed into the food chain. And these pesticide residues are monitored and enforced using maximum residue levels. You also hear maximum residue limits. And if you're talking about these measures in the US or Canada, they're also referred to as tolerances. But we're talking about the same thing, essentially. So what are MRLs? So the WHO defines this as the maximum residue limit is the highest level of a pesticide residue that is legally tolerated in or on a food or feed when pesticides are applied correctly in accordance with good agricultural practice. And if we look at our own legislation in Europe, MRLs are controlled under Regulation 396/2005. In this regulation, there's a lot of discussion about the need for pesticides, the way that they provide protection, ensuring yield and quality of products. But the definition relating to MRLs and the instruction is that MRLs should be set at the lowest achievable level, consistent with good agricultural practice for each pesticide, with a view to protecting vulnerable groups such as children and the unborn. So you'll see, even between the WHO definition and what we have in Europe, we refer quite strongly to good agricultural practice. And this will be mentioned a number of times as I'm presenting this morning. So what is good agricultural practice? Well, in its most basic form, it's the label recommendations for using that pesticidal product. But it's more controlled than this. So it really comes into the minimum dose that can be applied to a crop, ensuring an acceptable level of control for that weed, a pest or a fungi. So we bring in how a pesticide works, the level of control that it offers. So what we're trying to do is say, don't add too much, put on enough so there is excellent control. And the definition by the US EPA is very similar, and they refer to food security and food quality in their definition of GAP. So let's take a step back in time and go through the history. So I was lucky enough to be involved in our UPAC project a couple of years ago, which was looking at the development of pesticides, and it really was going back to the beginnings. And in this research that we carried out, there was pesticidal use of sorts reported as far back as Roman times, with chemical techniques such as smokes, minerals, oils, or plant extracts being reported to control pests and diseases.
Caroline, sorry to interrupt. If you want to put any slides up, you need to upload them. We can't do it from this end.
Okay, I can share it from my side, so it should be okay from now.
Thanks.
Okay. But really what we're talking about now when we talk about MRLs is really the rapid growth of pesticide use and development that occurred after the Second World War. And this saw the development of synthetic chemicals for crop protection, things like phenoxy acid herbicides, organochlorine insecticides, and dithiocarbamate fungicides, some of which are still in use today. And with this rapid development, it led to the regulations being developed for the sale and the use of pesticides by governments to prevent chemicals with unacceptable properties being introduced onto the market. So we have this legislation that's starting to come into place at the beginning of the 1950s, pretty much across Europe and also worldwide. And looking at how international harmonisation developed, in 1959, the Director General of the FAO convened a panel of experts on the use of pesticides in agriculture. And the panel was convened to look at the various problems that were connected with the use of pesticides. And with regard to pesticide residues, the panel concluded that governments should be urged to include, in addition to the public health authorities and the bodies involved in agricultural pesticide and plant protection, to advise on the regulations to control pesticide residue levels. So we have this rapid development of new chemistries, and in 1959, it's really being recognised that we should be doing something to control these levels in trade. This carried on and further developments happened. And in 1962, the FAO-WHO conference expressed the concern that there were differences in residue tolerances that were starting to appear between the different countries, but in some cases also between the different regions of the countries. And this was giving a lot of problems with trade. So we have the monitoring laboratories that are looking for these residues in trade. They find the residue and really don't know what to do about it. And the conference supported the principle that the amount of pesticide residue in food should not exceed that resulting from good agricultural practice, but recommended that governments should not adopt tolerances before an international agreement on the subject had been reached. So we see again this mention of good agricultural practice, and this runs as a theme whether we are talking about national or international harmonisation efforts. So we've talked about where they come from, but how do you set an MRL? So again, as you won't be surprised by now, everything starts with your GAP, your good agricultural practice. So once this has been set, then the researchers carry out supervised field trials at the critical GAP. So that's the combination of label recommendations that would give you the highest rate of application, the maximum number of applications, and the shortest interval between application and harvest. And what you can see is this is pushing you towards looking at the highest residues that you would be likely to achieve if the label was followed correctly. From those trials, samples are collected, and each sample will be analysed, and it will give you a measure of the residue present. And from then on, you make a statistical calculation of the MRL, which is based on the range of the residue levels that are measured in the trial. And you derive two values which are used in risk assessment. This is the HR, or the highest residue, or the STMR, which is the supervised trial median residue, which are used in the assessments. I'm going to try and share my screen now. Andrea, can you allow me to share my screen, please? Okay, so you should be able to see now a slide. It's actually, this is a calculation that's in the public domain. It was carried out by the JMPR, and you can see some real life residues data. So in this case, seven samples were taken, and you have the individual measures of the residues that were found. And as you can see, there is quite a range of the residues. They differ quite a lot, which is not unusual in a crop such as tea. Not sure if you can see my pointer on the screen, but the center box is the statistical calculation that gives you your MRL. So what this takes into account is the spread of this data here. And from this, it calculates what your MRL is. So your highest residue is in these trials is at the level of 2.1. But based on the spread of the data, the mathematical or the statistical model will give you an MRL of 5. And the reason for that is it comes back to the basics that I was taught in my first day in the laboratory, which is what you analyse, you cannot eat, and what you eat, you cannot analyse. So what we're trying to do in this way is to be able to model the upper level of the residues that are likely to be present. So far, we've talked a lot about the GAP, and we've not talked about consumer exposure assessments at all. But assessing safety is part of the process for setting an MRL, and I'll take you step by step through the process here. So from your GAP, you calculate your MRLs, you define the STMR and the HR. The median residues are used for chronic exposure, and the highest residues are used for acute exposure. These consumer exposures are assessed and compared to toxicological reference values. And if there are no problems with this, then the MRL is proposed. And you should be able to see a graphic which is very simply trying to outline about 500 hours of work that goes into doing this. So that you have your data here, looking at your metabolism and distributional studies. You define your residues for risk assessment and for your MRL. You define your MRL, your values for risk assessment, which go into your intake assessment, and whether an MR, whether this is found to be acceptable, means whether you will agree or refuse that MRL. So you can see the risk assessment is an integral part of setting an MRL, but the MRL itself isn't used in that assessment. I'm actually going to share the screen again because this is rather, sorry. Bear with me 1 second while I try and get this back for you. This is unfortunately a really difficult slide to describe. Under normal circumstances, I would be fine. Don't think you can actually see that.
Caroline, can you tell us which slide we might be able to put it up from this end?
Yes, slide 13, please, Andrea.
Okay, give us a moment.
Oh, absolutely perfect. Thank you. Now you can see why this is quite difficult to describe. So this is a slide taken from a publication I wrote probably over 15 years ago. You can see it relates to glyphosate, and this was written a long time before glyphosate became as famous as it is. And the reason I chose glyphosate is that it has the most enormous database in the public domain, and therefore there's a lot of data to work with. And it's also included in a lot of governments' monitoring programs. So I had the most enormous set of data to work with. And what you can see here with the blue, the purple bar, is actually the MRLs that are set for barley and for oats. And in the maroon or the purple bars, these are the median residues that are calculated as part of the MRL assessment. And these would be used for your chronic exposure assessments. And the reason being is that you wouldn't be exposed to the highest level of residues in every meal, every day of your life. The median is a much better value to show what happens in reality. But I wanted to take this assessment one step further and look at about how these residues compared to what was found in monitoring. So this very small yellow bar here, that's the maximum residue that was detected in monitoring programs. And you can see again, there's an enormous difference between the MRL and the STMR that's used in risk assessment, and then what's the highest level that's found in monitoring. And when you go down to the median value that was found in monitoring, it's virtually, you can't see it on the graph. So what I was trying to do with this publication is show how it's possible to overestimate consumer exposure. And you might say, well, that's not a bad thing. You're trying to protect consumers. Why shouldn't you overestimate exposure? But the difficulty here is that it leads to the loss of authorizations of pesticides that don't give risks to consumers. And what we're always trying to do with pesticide usage is make sure the consumers are protected, the environment's protected, but also that the farmers have a great armory of chemicals. And by going to these overestimates, we lose the usage of those pesticides, which puts farmers at a disadvantage, and it also leads to a loss of trade as well. Okay, thank you very much, Andrea. There'll just be one more slide to share at the end. So who uses MRLs? Well, virtually every country in the world uses MRLs for monitoring purposes in traded food, whether it's food that's produced by them or it's food that they're importing into their country. And in some cases, some countries don't have their own legislation, and then they adopt the MRLs from other countries. And this is typically those that are developed by Europe or the US are used in that situation. And it just goes to show the respect that our MRL systems have in these countries. And of course, there's internationally harmonized standards for MRLs that are developed via the Codex system. And these would be the standards that would be used in a dispute under the WTO, the World Trade Organization SPS agreement. Those would be the legal standards that would be used. But the farmers use the MRLs as well. They provide a level playing field for trade, and it really helps them when they're moving their products from one country to another. And it's particularly important for a region such as Europe, where we're not only big importers, but we're big exporters as well. And also the food retailers use MRLs, but they often set their own secondary standards, often lower than the MRL. And this gives a lot of challenges for farmers. They don't know which standard they should be using, the government standard, the MRL, or the one that's set by the food retailers, who are ultimately their customer. And part of this goes to a marketing ploy as well, that you see some supermarkets saying that the lower residues give consumers more safety. But part of the regulatory process is to ensure that those residues don't give rise to risks for consumers. I've mentioned harmonisation of MRLs. I've talked about the Codex system, those in the US, those in the EU. But if we step back not too far into Europe, actually, before our legislation came in place, there were almost 900 active ingredients, active substances that were not covered by EU MRL legislation in some country. For 650 of those, there were no specific MRLs. And for 250 of those, there were member state MRLs established. But sometimes they actually differed in the levels between the countries. And one of my first jobs as a regulator was to help in a trade dispute. Italian peaches had been exported into Germany and they'd been refused entry. So this is probably going back to the end of the 1980s now, so it's a while ago. And the difficulty here was the chemical wasn't registered for use in Germany, and therefore they had in effect a zero MRL in place. And this product had been completely used according to the label, completely legally in Italy. And mine was brought in to be able to demonstrate as an independent party that these residues wouldn't give rise to any consumer risks. So one of our questions was about MRLs and organic farming. And actually, it's very interesting because MRLs apply to all foodstuffs in the food chain, regardless of how they've been produced. But this does bring in another aspect, which is really important to us. And that's that not all chemicals need MRLs. It is possible to set MRL exemptions. And this could be for compounds that are naturally occurring, things like gibberellic acid, which you would find in plants. It's a growth hormone, whether a pesticide had been applied or not. There is a risk assessment that's carried out. That's part of the exemption process. But there is no point to use valuable resources in monitoring for something that's going to be naturally occurring. And also some of the antimicrobials like verticillium are also MRL exempt. And these are very low toxicity compounds, very hard to detect. And again, you're much better using your monitoring resources towards chemicals that have higher toxicities. And actually, going back to organic agriculture, some chemicals are permitted for use in organic agriculture and have MRLs. These are things like pyrethrins and copper. Andreas, could you share slide 17, please? Thank you. And I guess to conclude, I'd like to address the question that why aren't MRL safety standards? And I hope by now that you realise that the MRLs are measures of compliance with GAP. So they were designed in the beginning and have always been since the late 1950s. They are the checks to ensure that label recommendations have been followed. MRLs give us a great opportunity to set harmonised trading standards, and therefore are important to trade to ensure that we don't create artificial barriers within and between regions. And whilst MRLs are not safety standards, I hope I've been able to demonstrate to you that residues from crops treated according to the GAP must be assessed for their risk and must be shown not to lead to harm for consumers, so that assessing consumer safety is an integral step in setting in the process of setting an MRL. So thank you very much for your attention. I've been delighted to be able to give this information to you. And if there are any questions, I think there's an opportunity to put those into the chat box, and I will do my best to answer those for you. Thank you very much.
Caroline, first of all, on behalf of everybody, thank you for that very clear overview of the evolution of MRLs. Just while people are formulating their questions, I could maybe at least start by saying I was really amazed that you indicated it takes 500 hours to calculate an MRL. Maybe you could tell us who's doing that work.
So the work is done on two sides of the equation in Europe. So first, the people that are generating the data for submission, which is primarily the ag chem manufacturers, although sometimes grower groups also generate their own data. And to create a dossier of that information is an enormous task in itself. The calculation actually is fairly simple to carry out, but the summarization of the data, ensuring that it meets with the regulatory standards, that is an enormous piece of work. And then the regulators then have to carry out their assessment of this as well, which is no small task. Their role is in validating that data and ensure that they carry out an independent review of what's been provided by the manufacturers.
Okay, I'm just looking at the chat box here. As far as I can tell, there are no questions. Okay, I beg your pardon. Could you please send any chats, any questions to panelists? When you get the opportunity to actually make a question, you have to draw them to the attention of panelists. Okay, so we have a question. Caroline, can you see this one in your example and adding a bit? How could it be understood that for glyphosate, MRLs are 20 milligrams per kilogram for barley and oats, 10 for wheat, 2 for tea, and only 0.1 for coffee beans. Over to you, okay. Caroline.
Okay. It goes back to the good agricultural practice again. Glyphosate is used as a pre-harvest desiccant for things like cereals and lentils. So it's applied at the end of its growth period, and it will lead to detectable, or it has the potential to lead to detectable residues. For something like tea or for coffee beans, it's used for weed suppression. So I'm guessing this now, just looking at the MRL levels, that glyphosate is used as a herbicide around coffee plants. So there's no actual application to the coffee beans itself. The MRL is probably based on just some spray contamination that might happen onto the coffee beans. And the same thing for tea. If you applied glyphosate to tea, you would kill your tea garden. So again, it comes back to what I was saying. The good agricultural practice is the way that the label recommendations are described, and that's the way you would carry out your residue trials. But I think for that example, the real difference is use as a pre-harvest desiccant versus used as a herbicide applied to the ground around the crops.
Very good. There's another interesting question here, which organizations or institutions are carrying out the field trials that deliver the data used for MRL calculation?
Okay. So in most cases, it's the manufacturers, and the majority of manufacturers commission these studies with CROs, commercial research organizations. These studies are done to GLP to ensure that there's independent verification of these studies. And under GLP, there's the option for anybody to go in and inspect the data at any point in the process. Residue trials are also carried out by some of the grower organisations or institutes like IR4 in the USA, which is a government-sponsored programme to generate data for minor use crops. So to support the growers of things like herbs, which only form a minor part of sales and in the food chain. When it comes to the MRL calculations, so part of the dossier, and I'm just talking about submissions into Europe now, the MRL will be calculated by the submitting organisation, usually the agrochemical manufacturer, but those calculations are verified by the regulatory authorities, and then again by EFSA. So it goes through two stages of review in our European process.
Okay, another simple but important question. Well, what's an import tolerance?
Okay, it's an interesting one, an import tolerance. So for all intents and purposes, an import tolerance is an MRL for a crop or a pesticide that is not registered in the country of interest. So, for example, just trying to think of something. So in Europe, we don't grow coffee. So Brazil may request an import tolerance to export coffee containing a residue into Europe, and that would be the process is exactly the same. You follow through the GAP, you have your residues trials, you make your risk assessment, but that use isn't registered in Europe. It is an MRL for compounds that aren't registered in Europe. I think that's the easiest way. Compounds that aren't registered or crops that aren't grown in Europe, that's the easiest way to describe it.
Okay, we have another question here, which is when food is traded, which trade standards need to be respected?
That forms about 3 days of work of my week every week. And this is where the international harmonisation comes in. So it's basically the company, the importing country, is the MRL standard that needs to be respected. It would be great if we all used the codex standards throughout the world and then we had a level playing field, but I'm afraid that life isn't quite that simple. And regions have different ways of assessing the data. Scientists have different views of the data. But when it comes to which one should be respected legally into Europe, it should be the European MRL, which is respected.
Okay, I don't see any other written questions. So what I'd suggest we do now is just take a couple, we'll take a couple more online polls to see how well everybody has been listening to what they've heard. It's not really a test, but it'll be interesting to see what your perceptions are at this stage in the game. If there are any more questions whilst we do the online poll, again with menti.com, feel free to write them down. We have a bit of time left. Otherwise, we will draw things to a proceedings to a close after the questionnaire. Andrea, so. So do we have? So we have 13 responses. I'll just wait for 1 minute. Caroline, you've done quite well persuading people their trading standards, but not a perfect job.
No, no, yeah. 75%.
Obviously have to do better next time. Good, so should we move on to the next question? Is it possible to establish MRLs for pesticides which are not approved in the EU? That's a more difficult one. There seems to be more clarity on that one, Caroline.
I think there was that excellent question on import tolerances, which really helped with this.
Yes. Good. Well, look, I don't see. Oh, hang on, we have got some more questions. We go back to the questions, Caroline. Any thoughts how the understanding of politicians and policymakers can be further improved regarding MRLs?
It's a difficult one. I think it's really important that there's no mixed messages with MRLs. As you can see, I've looked from sources, not just from the European Union, but internationally, about the definitions of MRLs, how they're calculated, how they're defined. And it's very clear on the fact that they are trading standards that have a consumer safety element built into them. And we just have to keep having those conversations. I think for all eternity, there will always be differences between politicians and scientists. And it's our job as scientists to keep delivering those messages as clearly as we can. And also be respectful when there are concerns and take those concerns seriously and ensure that we put the time and effort to trying to provide answers, but more importantly, also say when we don't have the answers.
Very good. We've got a couple more questions, Caroline. This is a nice one. What happens if the residue is above the European MRL?
Oh, that's not good. In this situation, so we've maybe got a crop that's been picked up by a monitoring laboratory, one of the government monitoring laboratories. The first thing that happens is that there's a risk assessment that's carried out. That is absolutely the first thing. And that helps to put your actions into perspective. The first thing is that is an illegal residue. It is above the MRL. It is illegal to trade that food. However, because it's above the MRL doesn't mean that it's unsafe necessarily for the consumer, but you have to assess that first. So if it's shown to be safe, then there would maybe be a warning letter that goes to the retailer or the importer, wherever the sample was picked up, to ask them to give an explanation of what's gone on here. If the residue is found to be unsafe, then you need to take action with regards to withdrawing that crop from the market. The difficulty with government monitoring is it's often quite a lag phase between doing the analysis and the crop entering the market. But in any case, what normally happens if you have an MRL exceedance is the level of monitoring gets raised quite considerably, so that it's you should ensure that MRL is not exceeded again. And I think actually Europe has got a very good history of that. In particular, there are three regions that I see that act, or three countries that act very, very quickly. That's the Netherlands, Germany and Sweden. They have excellent monitoring facilities. They have state-of-the-art equipment, and they are probably well ahead of the game in terms of monitoring residues in Europe.
Okay, Caroline, your talking has obviously stimulated people's thinking, because there are some more questions now. How does the precautionary principle affect the setting of MRLs in the EU?
Oh, that precautionary principle is really, really difficult. As a scientist, you know that you can't know everything about every chemical. One of the committees that I sit on, the Committee on Toxicity, we look at a lot of naturally occurring chemicals, and I see the data that we have on the toxicity of those chemicals compared to what I would see for a chemical such as a pesticide or a food additive or something like this, and it's completely different. So we know that we can't know every scientific detail about every single chemical that we come into contact with our lives. The difficulty comes with the precautionary principle is it asks you to say that you know everything about every chemical, and actually we don't. And the risk assessments that we do build in a lot of uncertainty factors to try and cover the things that we don't know, to try and ensure that consumers are always always protected. And it's very difficult with that. I think the precautionary principle, I face a lot when I deal with consumers, and it's the trump card, because you cannot say you know everything about the safety of every chemical. But what we try and do with those risk assessments and the data generation is ensure that we can build in safety margins to take into account what we don't know.
Okay, there are a couple more, should we say, related questions. The next one says, do you feel that consumers are safe under the current situation with MRLs in the EU, or are they in danger?
Ooh. So in developing this, I spent quite a long time looking at the reports that are published by EFSA, which is the combination of all of the monitoring data from all of the labs in Europe. It's pretty impressive. There are literally hundreds of thousands of data points in there. All of these chemicals, where there's an MRL exceedance, there is an assessment carried out, and this is published. And on occasions, from chronic exposure, you really don't see anything that would give you a cause for lifetime exposure, whether you're a consumer that is an adult woman of childbearing age, an infant. We include those in all of our modelling, and we can be very confident that those residues aren't giving rise to any concerns. Occasionally, there will be a residue which will give rise to an exceedance of what's called the acute reference dose. So acute by its name, you know, a single exposure of a high level of chemical. And often these can lead to effects that are pretty, pretty mild. They shouldn't happen. I'm not condoning that, but it's things like it could be an upset stomach or a headache that could occur. And again, what I was mentioning before with the monitoring, when you see anything like this that occurs, it sends the warning light to the government laboratories, and those crops and those chemicals tend to be prioritised in the monitoring programmes to make sure that that's not a recurring theme that happens.
Okay, the next question I think is particularly of interest to the embassies, the foreign missions which are participating in this call, and that is, would you say that imports are more likely to be tested for being over MRL limits, given that they have to cross borders?
That's an interesting one. I'm just trying to think of the monitoring programs that I know in Europe. I mean, when you're prioritizing for these programs, you look at the items that are highly consumed, those that feature in the diet of children in particular. You look at compounds or where there's higher toxicity, and you look, as I've mentioned before, combinations of crop and chemical that have given problems in the past. Do governments target imports? Well, for some crops, the answer is yes. So I can remember from a few years ago, there was a lot of problems with the sugar snap peas coming in from Kenya. This is a crop that is also grown throughout Europe. There were many, many more samples taken from Kenya and Africa than there ever were from Europe. But there was a good reason for this, because there were MRL exceedances in the crops coming from Africa. Some of them were what I would call personally a technical exceedance, where we haven't set an import tolerance in Europe, and some of them were a true exceedance. I think in all of those cases, it was shown that there was no risk to consumers, but there was bilateral action that was taken to ensure that that situation was resolved.
Okay, so the questions are flooding in. We're near the top of the hour. We did say we did plan this to go on for another half an hour. So we're very happy to keep asking you questions if you're happy to keep answering them. I see that the numbers of people are beginning to decline. So for those of you who can't stay any longer, we really appreciate you having stayed. For those who have the appetite, I think there are a few more questions that we could look forward to hearing Caroline's answers. The next one is, how does the ELARA, as low as reasonable achievable, play a role for MRL setting?
Okay, so that's part of the process in the MRL setting with regards to using the GAP. So really, I described and I showed the mathematical models for calculating the MRLs, and the MRL will be higher than the highest residue that you've measured in your trials. But you don't set that MRL any higher than you should do, than your model predicts. And in some cases, organisations, not so much in the EU, but the GMPR will make an expert judgment. They will say, well, okay, in the example I gave, the MRL proposed was 5, but the highest residue was 2. Now, the MRL is almost, well, it's more than double the highest residue. So maybe a better compromise would be a lower level, maybe 4 or even 3. And then you would bring in expert judgment. One of the reasons that we've used the OECD calculator is to try and improve harmonisation and stop that expert judgment. But you know, as scientists, we like to go rogue on occasions.
Okay, so this is sort of building on the international theme. Another question here. European laboratories are going to extremely low LODs, lower levels of detection. However, these levels cannot be achieved in other regions of the world. Shouldn't we have a harmonized lab approach worldwide to avoid non-compliance and avoid labs' competitive advantage?
It's a really good question, Nat. And I look at some of the limits of detection, limits of quantitation that are routinely achievable now. And I look back to when I started working in the lab, which was quite a long time ago, admittedly. And I didn't even imagine of being able to get down to those limits of quantitation. So the analytical capabilities now are fantastic. This is really a difference between what the legal trading standard is, the MRL, and what the labs can achieve. If you find a detectable residue at a very, very low level and you have a limit of quantitation MRL, in theory, that's still a legal residue. So it's a really tricky situation. We should have harmonized lab standards because the labs have the capabilities of going lower. They do go lower without adding additional costs these days, but it does cause discrepancies, and there's no question it does cause difficulties for importers, and I believe it causes difficulties for governments as well when they have to deal with these. For me, and as somebody that used to be in charge of the budgets for monitoring in Europe, having very low limits of quantitation gives you additional costs. And in terms of consumer protection, this is a personal view, I would rather have a reasonable limit of quantitation and actually be able to analyse more samples, because personally I feel that gives the consumers a higher confidence in their foodstuffs when they can see more and more samples being analysed.
That, I think, Caroline, is a very good segue to our last question, which was how many samples are monitored each year?
Oh. You are in the world. So when I looked at the EFSA report, it literally was, this was data for 2018, and it was literally hundreds and thousands of samples. And it varies from country to country. There's a harmonised EU programme where the number of samples is actually defined by the voting structure in the EU. So the more votes you have, the more samples you have to analyse. But it's literally hundreds of thousands every year, and those are the ones that are in the public domain. That doesn't include any private monitoring that might be done by the supermarkets for their own purposes.
Okay, well, Caroline, thank you for answering all those questions. That brings us to the end of the questions in the chat. We had a couple of questions for the audience, actually. Andrea, if you could put the Menti up as well, and if anybody else has any questions, feel free to pose them whilst we answer these questions. So the first one we have is, which other topics would you like the agricultural science policy webinar series to address in the future? We've got international trade, why is it needed? Cocktail effect, secondary standards from retailers, food companies, codex standards versus national standards, precautionary principle. The two legislative system in the EU, approval of active substances and MRLs, and farm to fork and related pesticide reduction targets, implementation and implications. We've got digital innovation. Some very good ideas there. Good. Thank you very much. Oh, we've got another one. Cocktail effects, secondary standards, setting up import tolerances. Precision farming, realistic exchange of views on view on opportunities. We'll just wait for one more minute and then we'll go on to the next question. Okay, let's go on to the next question. I think the final question, Andrea. Okay, so we'd appreciate your feedback on the format, any suggestions you have for improvement for the future agricultural science policy webinars. Well, while you're thinking about any feedback, and we appreciate this particular one on the Q&A, we had a feeling it would be probably the most interesting part of the event. I'd like to say a huge thank you to you, Caroline, for answering all of these questions, for your very clear presentation, for sharing your thoughts and your perceptions with us. I'd like to say a big thank you to everybody who dialed in for your active participation. And we look very much forward to meeting up again. Our next agricultural science policy webinar will be presented by Professor Marcus Frank from Nürtingen-Gieslingen University, and he will talk about measuring agricultural sustainability. With that, I think we draw it to a close. Thank you all again, and we look forward to being in touch. And just remember, if you have any further questions or concerns, Caroline's very kindly agreed to receive your questions. You will all receive a copy of Caroline's full presentation slide set, which is much more than you saw today. On the final slide, you have Caroline's contact details, email, telephone. Thank you again, Caroline. We really appreciate it. And thank you all for being part of our science, agriculture science policy webinar. And I think that draws us to an end. So cheers and goodbye. Take care, everybody.
Thank you.
BASF, we create chemistry.